All right, welcome to the Lovecraft E-Zine video cast and podcast. Today is September the 18th, 2016. You might want to step away from your monitor or not wear earbuds if you're listening later because I have strep. So, but such is my dedication to authors like Matt Bartlett. Now, if I didn't have technical difficulties last week, I probably would have asked you if you minded rescheduling, but you can't reschedule every Sunday. At least that's what the listeners tell me.
Right.
Okay, so Matt, thanks for being on the show.
Thanks for having me.
Sure. And we'll do some brief introductions, go down the line, and then we'll just all talk to Matt. So why don't we start on Joe's side of the screen and work our way over.
I'm Joe Polver, writer, editor.
Kelly.
I'm Kelly Young. I am the executive editor of Strange Eons magazine.
Okay, we'll skip Matt and go to Matt Carpenter. That didn't work out. Why did you guys have to sit next to each other? Matt Carpenter.
Hi, I'm Matt Carpenter. I help edit the Lovecraft Museum on occasion.
Pete. Pete.
I'm Pete Rolick, writer. What?
Good. What? Very good. Good job.
You keep calling my name.
I think you had a delay or something. Wow. All right, so you're a writer. Good.
That's good.
All right. Philip. Are you a writer too?
I am, yeah. Philip Farkasi, horror writer and screenwriter.
And SP.
SP Miskowski, fiction writer.
All right, so Matt Bartlett, for those in the audience who don't know who you are, could you kind of start from the beginning and tell us who you are and when you kind of came on the scene with your writing?
Sure. I self-published a book in summer of 2014, Gateways to Abomination. It kind of made the rounds a little bit and picked up a little bit of notice. I self-published a second book called The Witch Cult in Western Massachusetts a little bit later on down the line. And my latest book from Muzzleland Press is called Creeping Waves. I've had short stories in, there it is, short stories in Resonator and now I'm going to blank, Noibus and a few other things. But 2014 summer is when I came on the scene.
Dim Shores did Wrangle.
Dim Shores did Wrangle, yep. Yep, that's
Rangel.
True.
I'm sorry, I mispronounced. No,
that's okay. Yeah, I don't know why I skipped that one, but that one ended up. It's in Creeping Waves.
Well,
and year's best weird fiction, right?
It will be in the third volume of Year's Best Weird coming out soon, October, early October. Well,
that's right. Sam Cowan, when he was on a couple of weeks ago, said something about that. Yeah, thanks for the reminder, SP.
Sure.
Yeah, and you'd think I'd know how to pronounce that particular title because you sent it to me at first and then decided to make some changes to it. Is that basically what happened?
That's what happened. The one I had sent you was an early version and I began to have misgivings and
about me or the story.
About the story, definitely. And it just, I felt it needed such extensive reworking that I apologetically withdrew it from consideration. And by then it was, a little bit late in the game. So, and Sam was looking for something from me. So, yeah, that's what happened with that one.
So you stiffed Mike Davis.
I did. Yeah, and I feel, yes. The first thing I want to do is step on toes left and right if I can.
No, I kind of figured it was half me too because if I remember correctly, at any rate, I took a while to get back to you because I was going through so many submissions.
Sure, I imagine. I can't imagine the volume that you had to go through.
But let me emphasize, guys, that I am actually even sicker than normal. So please feel free to jump in with questions for Matt Bartlett and cut me off if need be.
I have a question.
Please do.
Okay. Matt, I know the story of how Gateways to Abomination came about, but I think it's really, really interesting. So could you kind of go back to when you started with the short pieces online and how you kind of developed the idea, and then you just sort of gradually, I'm not going to tell your story. Okay, you go ahead.
Sure. Yeah, no, I, in late 2004, I think, or early 2005, a friend of mine on LiveJournal had started up a fictional blog, and it was short stories about a small town. It was done in a humorous vein, and I instantly thought I would like to do something like that, but I wanted to do, my love was horror, so I thought, well, I'll do something more horror-oriented. And the idea that I came up with at the time was a radio station, mysterious radio broadcasts that came from who knows where into this town in Western Massachusetts where I live. And I just started off doing kind of humorous but horrific stories, and they would be very short, a paragraph, usually accompanied by an old picture I would find online or in a antique store. So I would sort of look at the picture, and if it suggested some sort of strange story to me, I would tell that story, whether it was a paragraph or a page or a couple pages. And I would update it every day sometimes three times a day, sometimes a few days would go by without my doing anything. And just over the years, it accumulated into something that I thought could be put together. And I, in a way, it was me telling myself this story through smaller stories, and it all, in the end, was sort of a piece. So I put it together and made a book out of it.
And Gateways is a wonderful, wonderful book.
Thank you.
But before we get too far, there's X number of people out in the universe at this point who think, writer, he's self-published a couple of books, or she, and nowadays anybody can self-publish. So, wow, big deal, they can't be any good because they're self-published. And perhaps that's true for a majority of writers. I mean, there is a lot of self-published stuff out there that you don't want to even use for, you know, liner for your parakeet cage. But in your case, that's absolutely not the case. So before we get too far, for those people who think, oh, self-published, well, I don't know about that. You want to tell us some of the blurbs you have by some notable people?
Let's see. I don't know if I can pull any off the top of my head. I can look at the back of, look at the back of the book. And well, my first prominent review was Justin Steele in Arkham Digest, who said, I fully anticipate this book to be considered by many to be a modern cult classic. And I very much look forward to more from Mr. Bartlett. Highly recommended. There's something special at work here. And in his introduction to Creeping Waves, which is my first non-self-published collection, Nathan Ballingrad said some wonderful things about Gateways to Abomination. He said he had picked it up not expecting much, and it was like he'd walked into traffic on a busy highway. He so people have liked it, and it's very gratifying. And go ahead. I'm sorry.
Oh no! I just you're not, like I said, there's a plethora of self-published material out there that, you know, we should all run away from like the plague.
Agreed.
But I was late to the game. I kept hearing from your name, you know, from notable people, and you know who they are. Oh, you know, I'm in Germany, so.
That's an interesting writing problem, too. Sorry, Joe. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Oh, no, that's okay. So something like Wrangle, chapbooks, I pay almost, I pay more for shipping than I do for the actual product, you know, and there's nowhere over here where you can just walk in and stuff is on a shelf and you can buy it. So, you know, I'm always at this point pretty far behind. Gateways, I thought was mind blowing. I thought it was really wonderful. And WXXT, I think is a marvelous invention. I couldn't get enough of it. And I see someone's put out WXXT t-shirts.
Yes. Yep, from Scurvy.
Yeah, Sam, okay. I thought, wow, that's marvelous. That's just a great idea. So go ahead. I'm sorry.
No, that's okay. It's really crazy to see something that I, you know, basically put out there for a few friends in the early 2000s take on a life of its own with people doing fan art and t-shirts and buttons. It's kind of surreal to me. But I'm proud of the book.
You know, since you mentioned that introduction that Nathan Ballingrud wrote for Creeping Waves, I just want to say I've read a few books recently that had really kind of skimpy introductions. And this is a great one. This is so apt and descriptive and so respectful of the book. I loved it. I really, it's a brief introduction, but it's very well done. You should be really proud of that. He really got it. He really, really dug into the work and obviously loved it. So great introduction, great book.
Yeah, I really, when I saw it, he sent it to me in an email. I was at work. I immediately scurried away to a quiet conference room and read it in the conference room. And yeah, I mean, you, there's no real words to describe how you feel when you read something like that by a writer who you have tremendous respect for and whose stories you absolutely love. And I loved and love Nathan's work. So, yeah, it blew me away.
Yeah, he did a great job.
He did. He did.
Hey, Matt.
Yes.
Had you attempted to get Gateways of Abomination to a mainstream publisher before you decided to self-publish, or can you talk a little bit about that process?
Sure. I did not, to be honest with you. I knew that I was an unknown name. I had nothing published anywhere, nothing substantial. So I really didn't, you know, came in as an absolute novice, had no idea whether it would be anything a publisher would ever be interested in a million years. So the route I went of self-publishing, sort of the way I was, the way I grew up, my brother fronted like punk rock bands and they made their own records and they did their own record covers and they, you know, they worked with their friends and things like that. So it was kind of in that spirit that I undertook the project. I don't know that I would have done it the same way if I had it to do over, but it seems to have done fairly well, so I can't say that I would. But I'll tell you, after Justin Steele's review, I hastened to try to contact a few publishers because Justin said in his review, I wouldn't be surprised to see this republished, you know, by a publisher. So I thought, ooh, it's good that he said that, and I kind of sort of looked at it, shopped it around a little bit sort of after the fact, and but it was too early. It hadn't accumulated any real notice yet. So, yeah, so I never really attempted anything with publishers.
Seriously.
I think it's funny how – oh, I'm sorry, Joe.
No, that's okay. I just think it's –
you go ahead.
You first, SP.
Okay. I just think it's strange that, you know, if you put out your own music, right, people think that you're badass. If you make an independent film, people say, oh, good for you. But if you publish your own book, you still have to explain to people, no, it's worth reading. It's good. Until they pick it up and they actually read it. And then, of course, you know, I would just like to to see the books get more and more attention as they are before, you know, but I'm sure they will be republished. I'm sure they will be. But the reputation that Gateways has developed all on its own is just really wonderful. It's great to see that that someone can accomplish that. And you weren't out there. I didn't see you out there pushing the book or anything. It's just, this is a matter of people loving this book and loving these stories and passing the book on to their friends, telling other people about it. So it's a great thing.
Yeah, Phil, go on. Anytime. Oh,
thanks. Yeah. Hey, Matt. It's Philip. Hi. Yeah, one question I was going to ask is, did you, regarding the self-published book, the first one, is there a limited amount of those made, or is it open-ended? So is it still technically in print?
It is technically in print. It's print on demand.
Okay.
Through CreateSpace. So yeah, there is, it's on Amazon and generally available.
Yeah. The reason I ask, and it's maybe a separate conversation, but is because I was having a chat recently with a friend who's a writer and who's published by one of the big five, as it were. And we were talking about, at what point does a publisher actually help? At what level does a publisher actually have enough promotional input or have enough financial input or whatever that it actually has a significant enough difference from what a self-published book is? Even publishers who are fairly prominent in the indie world, it doesn't seem to be that much discrepancy between what they can provide and what an author who self-publishes can provide the book. You know, there's basic upfront costs such as design and, you know, maybe layout and maybe a proofreader. But for the most part, even, you know, publishers are distributing the same way. They're distributing via the internet and via websites and stuff like that. Now a lot of publishers, you know, put you into the bookstores or put you into libraries. And I think that's where there's a separation between, okay, now the publisher is really taking my book to the next level. But my point is, if you talk about republishing your first book, I don't know if it would even make that much of a difference in that what you've already done has been you've had such a level of success with it that I feel like you've done probably, you know, as well as a lot of publishers could have done had they taken it on and put their brand on it. You know, I think you've done an exceptional job even with the time and restrictions you've had.
Thank you. Yeah. It's, I sort of, my goal one day is to have the thing reviewed in RumOrg. That was always my goal. I sent them a copy in a special black envelope, you know, and it's probably sitting on the bottom of a pile somewhere right now. But I do see that some publishers do have more ways of getting the book out there and reviewed. It's tough because a lot of sites will, as a matter of principle, not review self-published books. So that kind of, that was frustrating.
Which is a shame.
It is, but it's understandable. I mean, I do understand that there is a lot of bad stuff out there, and that there's, you know, maybe a deserved reputation of, you know, CreateSpace made books with, you know, shoddy covers and no editing and, you know, just poorly done altogether.
Right.
Well, that's one of the things that a good publisher brings. It's, you know, here's a publisher, and we could pick out any one of a number of names. They have a catalog. It's well established. It's very well respected. You know that the work you're about to read when you purchase it has been vetted. And all of a sudden, let's say, here's a book by Matt Bartlett that follows books by such and 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 such. Well, if this publisher is now going to publish this new Matt Bartlett guy you hadn't heard of, while they also publish these other people, you know, this cat's no slouch. Go ahead, Pete.
I'd like to build on something that Philip brushed on briefly, but, you know, for all the ideas of getting this out to a real publisher or a big five or a mainstream publisher, man, I gotta say, the stories that just sort of end,
mm-hmm.
they're very disquieting. You know, that sudden abrupt ending with no real denouement sort of just it creates a sort of disquieting feel that, you know, something has been sliced away. And it's very unsettling. And the way that some of the stories are broken up and come back to chapters or stories later, it's like, oh wait, this story's not done. You know, I don't know that you would a real publisher, a mainstream publisher with a mainstream editor would have allowed you to do that.
Yeah, that's a good point.
Because it doesn't follow a strictly linear kind of storytelling, which I think is a huge benefit, because it leaves the at least it left me feeling very uneasy.
Mm-hmm.
And you, in Gateways to Abominations, there's like this one line, oh, the FCC agent arrived today. And then it's over. And it's like, and then all the way toward the end of the book, he shows, you know, he's back. It's like, wait, what? And so it's very non-linear, but very non-sequitur, very broken up. And yet it works really, really strikingly well.
Thank you.
And I don't know that you would have gotten away with that if a mainstream publisher would have picked this book up.
That's sometimes they don't know what to do with something remarkably unusual and different.
Right.
I have an edition of a Caitlin Kiernan book on my shelf that she absolutely hated the cover. It was a reprint. And they felt the need to use three different fonts to distinguish between what a character was writing and what they were reading and what was actually happening. And it's just a mess. It's a terrible edition. And, you know, just because it's a traditional publisher doesn't mean that they're going to take the time and the care that's necessary, or that they will recognize, I mean, they might be wonderful, but they also might not recognize something extraordinary. As Pete's saying, I mean, they might have made suggestions that would have been detrimental. I don't know how you feel about that, Matt, but it's possible.
No, I agree. I have to say, I like it as it is. And, I'm proud that I, you know, put it together myself and edited it and had some, you know, three different people do copy editing, and I put a lot of care into it. And it is something special, I think, to say that I, you know, here's a thing that I did, you know, largely on my own, obviously with the help of loved ones and things like that, but without the input of a publisher or a professional editor.
Matt, I'm curious about
you. I think it's a magnificent achievement.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I'm curious about your past experiences and thoughts on radio stations, DJs, the experiences that you've had that led to this.
I had a college radio show with a friend of mine. It was very irreverent, very juvenile, but it gave me a little bit of time inside a radio studio. So that, you know, may or may not account for one, you know, the idea that your own voice is out there in the world is pretty interesting and strange experience. But largely I was inspired by the monologues of a writer and radio monologuist named Joe Frank, who did a lot of radio plays and strange sort of monologues and vignettes, and just a tremendously creative guy with a profoundly unsettling voice, I thought. And the idea, I would drive around in my car and listen to this, you know, voice coming out of the speakers at night. And that kind of got me going and set me off. And his monologues were not really horror related, although they did touch upon a lot of frightening things, a lot of meditation on death and things like that. But I wanted to do something with a surreal, lurid sort of horror bent to it, along those lines. And beyond that, I mean, just as a teenager, I listened to the radio all the time. You know, a lot of classic rock, you know, and the usual things. But yeah,
there's something about live radio that, as much as I enjoy podcasts, and I do enjoy them quite a lot, and hopefully anyone listening to this enjoys them, but that you can't quite capture with live radio, you know. Yep. Because it is live, and you might be listening to that voice in the dark going down the highway, or, you know, in bed while you're falling asleep, and, you know, somewhere 50 miles away, somebody's listening to that same voice.
Yep. It's interesting. And also the local aspect of it, the knowing that that voice is the what's generating that voice is somewhere nearby, can also be an interesting prospect. Like, you don't know what that, I mean, now with the internet and everything, you're far more likely to know what that person looks like, but otherwise it's just a disembodied voice. You have no idea where it's coming from or what the person is behind it, or if there is a person behind it.
What attracted you to... Go ahead, Pete, go ahead.
Oh, I was just going to, just to expand on that thought.
Yeah.
My friend, Vince, 50 miles from where in Jersey, basically at the exact same time, but we didn't know each other. We didn't, but what we did share, which we discovered, you know, a couple of years ago, was that we all watched the same television channels, the same UHF channels. We watched the same crappy little programs, you know, Dr. Schlock and, you know, the horror theater. Just that, transmission that we both remember so fondly is what really bound us together.
There's a new anthology, I think. I think it's called Lost Signals. I think you have a story in it, Matt.
Yes, that's right. I have two stories in that one, actually, published by Perpetual Motion Machine Publishing, Max Booth, and a woman whose name is escaping me at the moment, Lori Michelle. But yeah, it's a radio-themed anthology. So I was able to get two of my WXXT-themed stories in there.
It's an interesting idea. I've thought about it before, so I'm going to have to definitely pick up Lost Signals as well. Are those reprints, or are they original stories in Lost Signals?
The ones from me are original stories.
Okay.
Yep.
No, I was just going to ask a minute ago, what brought you to weird fiction and horror in the first place?
Sure. I grew up with a family of readers. My grandparents, well, let me start. First, my grandfather, my maternal grandfather, gave me, he knew I liked the universal monsters, the Frankenstein and the Mummy and the Wolfman and Dracula, and I liked them from pictures I saw in books as a child. I never saw the movies or anything, but the pictures were just, they really captivated me. So my grandfather, knowing this, got me a copy of the novelization of the movie The Omen, which probably was a little much for 11, 12-year-old boy, but I really liked it. Not long after that, my grandmother gave me a copy of Christine by Stephen King. I think I was 13 or 14. I plowed through that book and was really taken with horror altogether. I came to Lovecraft very late. I would say probably in the early 2000s. And Ligotti not long after that, just from looking at books in a bookstore. And those books sort of blew me away in terms of, well, this is hard to explain, but Stephen King seems to have this way of knowing everything, the way like a journalist does or something. And when I read his fiction, I thought, this is wonderful, tremendous stuff, but I could never, ever do it. But then when I sort of started reading more Lovecraft and Ligotti and weird fiction, I thought there are other ways to convey horror than sort of building or having to describe a lot of details of real world things. I'm not putting this quite the way I want to, but...
No, I think I know what you mean, yeah.
Yeah, Stephen King seemed to know everything.
And, technical knowledge of a variety of different things. Or exactly. Something, at least a general technical knowledge.
Right, and then I think as he got bigger and bigger, he had a lot of people to give him that information or advise him on things like that. So it wasn't until I read, weird fiction like Lovecraft, Ligotti, Robert Aichman, the names we all know, that I thought maybe I can do something in this vein, something different.
I wanted to come back to Rangel for a second because I forgot to ask you. I'm going to read the quote. I forget which interview it was, but I found it online earlier today. You wanted to make some changes to it. And you had a strange experience of the mall. Here's the quote. I read you were in the restroom of Thorns, a kind of oddball city mall in downtown Northampton. A man came out of a stall and started going on and on about people taking pictures in the restrooms, and then he follows you down the street.
Yes, yeah. Yeah, what's up with that? Yeah, Northampton has interesting people there. And yeah, he just kind of burst out of the stall next to mine as I was coming out and started babbling about taking pictures in the stall. And he stood next to me at the sink when I washed my hands and followed me out and down the street, just kind of doing this running monologue. And I thought, what does this person want? Does he think I was taking pictures in the restroom? And he peeled off and went away. And that gave me, I think, a crucial middle scene in the book. It kind of put a new character in the book and brought it back to life for me. So yeah, that was kind of one of those things that happens to you and you're like, I can't not use this,
Yeah. Yeah.
It's interesting how when you do bring up details again and again in the stories, it acquires this very spooky resonance, I remember that scene and it's really spooky. But I love the way that you, as Pete was saying, you might drop a line, you might say something that seems almost inexplicable. And then later on, there will be mention of it again. And it starts to, but in a different context, and you'll start to get a very eerie sense that things are being said or written or things are happening that you can't quite put your finger on. You can't quite get to the source of what's going on. It's a beautiful, spooky feeling.
Thank you. I like to do that, to reference back to stories. I sometimes look at gateways and I think I can tell more about this story later on in a future book and refer back to something that happened in gateways or a line in gateways or something like that. And that prospect is very amusing to me, the idea that I can kind of go back and even maybe finish the stories that seemed like they were cut off in the middle, or provide a beginning to a story that seems like it just jumped onto the page halfway through. It's kind of like I have seen it as a big jigsaw puzzle, and I like to be able to, go back and pop in a piece from a mostly completed scene, from miles back.
Well, you have these community bits of information too, lost people, lost pets, lost things. Mm. But the descriptions of them are so bizarre that you wonder who wrote this, who would post this, and do they really want this person back and for what purpose? It's great because it's information that you would think was meant for the community, for people in town to read, but there's something odd about it, something slanted about it, like it shouldn't be seen. You're letting out a little bit of somebody's very, very private existence that shouldn't be seen anywhere.
Yeah, the stolen diaries from the preacher.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
I want those back, but you know, I'll give you more money if you don't read them.
Yeah.
Yeah, I like the selling stories in kind of strange ways like that. And for those, I used our daily paper has a kind of a 200 years ago feature with little snippets and bits that you'd never see in a newspaper now. They're often, you know, runaway wives or runaway slaves or unsavory things like that. So I sort of reproduce them with an odd edge, you know, or, you know, something a little off kilter or a lot off kilter.
In some senses, I was thinking as I'm reading the Gateways, and this is like scenes for characters in search of a horror novel.
Mm. Yeah. Yeah.
Because there's obviously something much bigger going on around them,
mm-hmm.
and we're just getting little vignettes of it, and those in themselves are terrifying. But it's obviously much bigger than what's going on with these few people.
Right.
And WXXT is binding it all together. Really, yeah.
And I have a question.
Really enjoyable.
I have a question for Matt. Regarding that, to riff off what Pete's saying and SP, you know, I was just thinking, you know, when you first started producing the stories and you said you were doing it online, right?
On the internet?
Yeah. And which reminds me very much of Pen Pal, the book Pen Pal that was novel and became, the guy who self-published it and it became a monster bestseller.
Mm-hmm.
Same with The Martian. That was also initially a serial online. Andy Weir book. But the point being, man, as I was wondering, and I apologize if this is being done and I'm not aware of it, but I was wondering if you're still doing any of this stuff online, because I was just thinking how cool it would be, given the way you construct your books, to have portions of them, stories that are in the books, and portions of the stories that are available in other mediums, but they all kind of connect. That would be, your style and the type of stories you write would be such a natural fit for doing something really outside the box like that.
That's true. Yeah. I haven't really considered that lately. I've been, you know, concentrating on longer pieces, not necessarily connected to the WXXT thing, but it's definitely something to think about down the line. And people have also mentioned that they would like to see something like a podcast or something like a recorded piece or an original piece. And mm-hmm. yeah, I don't know. It's there's certainly a lot that could be done with it, and I'll have to write down some notes and see what
podcast would be very spooky.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it could mm-hmm. be if it was done right. Yeah.
Hey Matt, I love that idea of the podcast and everything, but I also have this little thing here that I really dig. Can you talk a little bit about Anne Gare's rare book and ephemera catalog that came out and how that kind of fits into the Bartlett verse?
Sure, absolutely. In Gateways to Abomination, there is a bookstore called Anne Gare's Rare Books or something like that. And I was sitting at work one day at a quiet moment on a break, and I was thinking about the descriptions of books like on ABE Books or on eBay or on online retailers that sell used and rare books, and how my father-in-law used to own a virtual bookstore through ABE Books, and his descriptions of the books would be, there'd be a lot of his personality injected to it and into it, and they were very wry and witty and smart. So as a kind of a goof, I wrote one down, and it's the one, and I'm not going to remember the title of it now, but it's in Anne Gare's catalog. It's the one that isn't really horror related. It's kind of a humorous piece about a strange guy who I think self-publishes his autobiography. And I got such a kick out of writing it, I started to write more and use the Gateways universe as a jumping off point to make up these non-existent books. And then I would look at the, you know, descriptions online of the way books were bound and things like that and put them in there. And I thought, you know, by then I was very well aware of the stigma attached to self-publishing. And I thought, you know, I'm going to like self-publish the hell out of this thing. I'm going to bring it to a copy shop, and, you know, get 50 copies of it made, and sell them online. And that's going to be it. And excuse me. So yeah, I did that, and I those stories connect to things in the witch cult in Western Massachusetts and in Gateways. Some of the books, some of the stories from that catalog appear in Creeping Waves, but not all of them. Yeah, it was just kind of a fun project to do, and something I thought I would do all on my own without Create Space and without anything other than, you know, me and the people at Paradise Copies in Northampton.
Yeah, as a fan of your work and just the collector mentality that I have, I love that this little thing exists, and I love how rare it is and how small the print run is, and it's also available for sale for $1 million if anybody wants.
I have a strong fondness for that one myself.
Yeah, what's your phone number, Kelly? If you want to give that out, then people can...
yeah, I'll give that out after the show.
Matt, what are some of the things that scare you or disquiet you or that you find uncomforting that inspires some of your work?
Well, it's kind of the mundane fears that everybody has, I think, the fear of essentially having the rug pulled out from under you, losing a job or, losing things to a fire or, you know, things like that. It's kind of at the end of life, you know. And so I think that I, when I write, I translate that into having the rug, having reality pulled out from under you. When big things happen in your life, everything suddenly seems surreal and wrong, and the stability is gone. So that kind of thing scares me. The prospect of loss, the prospect of loss of everything. So yeah, that's it. And ghosts, terrified of ghosts.
You're terrified of ghosts, but I don't think you believe
in. I'm just kidding.
I was going to say, he's either kidding me or there's some cognitive dissonance going on.
Right.
Because I think I saw somewhere else you don't believe in consciousness after death, and that.
Oh yeah, no. I'm sorry. Like just off screen, two of my cats are having a fight, so I'm just going to remove a cat from the premises. Okay. No,
Larry.
Yeah, that was Larry. Larry sailed by. No, I, you know, that's something I think about and wake up in the middle of the night and think of, oblivion and all cheery things like that, you know? So yeah, I'm kind of I can be a bit of a morbidly obsessed person, and I just try to have a sense of humor about it and maybe deal with it a little bit in the writing and things like that. But yeah, I'd love to believe in some kind of consciousness going onwards after death, or some kind of something, anything. You know, I really enjoy consciousness. So yeah, that's kind of the dark places I go in my head are pretty much revolve around death.
You, me, and Carl Sagan. But I also noticed that you... One of the things I did find comforting when I was thinking about this kind of thing a very long time ago, started to think about it a long time ago, I should say, is the idea that while you were not conscious for an eternity before your birth, and I found it interesting that actually does not comfort you personally, that you don't get any comfort from that.
In a way, it's even worse. Like, where the hell was I? You know, I don't like that. It's funny, I don't like to think about it, but I like to read other people work through it. It's kind of a strange thing. I think it may be the sort of feeling that you're not quite alone in thinking about that and maybe thinking about it more than you ought to and things like that. But yeah, I find that even, in a way, even more scary, you know.
Well, if you like hearing how other people work it out, I'll just give you my personal take on it, which isn't really mine personally. But I don't know, maybe 9 or 10 months ago, I did an interview with Legati on this site. And he said something to me in an email about when you go for an operation that they have to knock you out for.
Right.
And, you know, it's almost like turning off a light.
Yeah.
You know, 1 second you're there and 1 second you're not. And he described it as a very, very peaceful feeling. And so this was before my operation. So our procedure actually wasn't really an operation. So I went and did the procedure and they're like, you know, count backwards from whatever. And I did that. And that was it. Hmm. And I thought about it. I've had procedures done before, of course, and had to been knocked out for reasons before, but I'd never really looked at it in that light. And, you know, his take on it was, well, barring some kind of painful death, this is what death is like. You know, you just don't wake up at the other end of it. But right. did you really, you didn't sense anything while you were under, you know? No, you didn't.
Right.
So I don't know that I've ever, for a long time, been afraid of it personally, but it's certainly an uneasy topic for anybody who's not immortal, which is to say all of us.
That's true. So, yeah.
You know, that was a bit comforting. And, you know, ironically, coming from someone like Tom Ligotti,
right,
to comfort me about mortality.
it's very interesting. The same thing, I had a similar experience when I had surgery a couple of years ago, and I was terrified because I'm a hypochondriac. I'm afraid of everything. I'm afraid of all pain, everything. And it was just blank silence. And yeah. Ever since, I've had less of a sense of fear about, you know, the unknown and mortality in general. I just, I'm not cavalier about it, but I think, oh, blank silence. I've experienced that. Okay. Okay.
That's the beauty of it. Finally, the pain goes away. There's nothing. We have no more shame, no more embarrassment, no more regrets. We don't have to go over and over and over our sins. our heartbrokenness, our, you know, the pain goes away. I bring it on.
right now, Young's going, what sins? What the hell is he talking about?
Well, what were you saying, Pete, about waking up?
Oh, yeah. A couple years ago when I tore my Achilles and they went in to repair it, uh-huh. I woke up mid-surgery.
Oh, no.
And got a good look at everything going on.
Mm-hmm. Wow. And,
that's, you know, terrifying.
That is not comforting whatsoever.
Well
I've had surgery with anesthesia, you know, where I was conscious of the procedure that was being performed, but I didn't feel anything, you know. But my great fear is the pain, because I've experienced that coming out of anesthesia, and, you know, they haven't given me enough painkillers to make that subside, and just kind of shrieking. That's frightening, but yeah. Death itself.
A friend of mine went in for back surgery and afterwards started experiencing night terrors. And went to a therapist for it, and they pulled his medical files. And it looks like instead of giving an actual painkiller, they used an amnesiac. It basically just made him forget the pain.
Wow. Which,
oh, that's weird.
That's crazy. Yeah.
Lawsuit.
Yeah, so he's not particularly happy.
Well, there's nothing
Before we jump ahead of ourselves, certain medications do both. For example, fentanyl. It's commonly used in anesthesia because it's short acting. So, you know, before you leave,
how much did you have tonight, Matt?
Welcome back, Matt.
Thought you'd slip one past me.
Well, we'd get doctors and see if you woke up.
Don't forget, though, there's a lot of people who during surgeries have out-of-body experiences. It's well documented, yeah. So it's not all just blank space. And I hate to burst everyone's bubble. you morbid bastards. But,
I'm sorry.
Good Lord.
Well documented means they anecdotal doesn't mean that's not evidence. Well, though.
I've read many books on the subject. It's pretty well documented.
I have
is over the years I've had buku procedures, and at this point it was lights out, and I don't know, I kind of looked at it like heroin. It's like for a period of time everything went away. I wasn't there, I didn't have to worry about anything that wasn't big and ugly and mean, and I, you know, it just, that's it. Peace.
So Joe, tell us about your extensive history with heroin.
I'm deathly afraid of needles.
Yeah, me too.
You know what you and I do a couple of times a day with needles. Do you understand the terror I have twice a day putting that needle in me?
Joe, I'm off.
Oh, good for you.
Yeah. I'll talk to you about it later.
You know, wonderful news. I am not off.
So,
what's Matt's next book about?
Yeah, let's talk about Matt. Talk about Matt Bartlett.
Yeah, let's go from death to what Matt is writing now. What
it actually is probably not a bad sequitur.
I've got a short collection due out from Dunham's Manor Press, I think in early 2017, that is stories not related to WXXT, not related to that whole mythology, although some of them do take place in Leeds. And it's something a little bit different with some stories that are not interconnected, just to kind of show a kind of a different side, I think. I'm very excited about it. Dave Felton will be doing the cover and the interior art, which I am very excited about. I love what he does, and yeah, he's shown me a little bit. I posted, I think, earlier a promotional bit of art by him on Facebook that I'm excited about. So yeah, that's what's next. And otherwise, I'm working on probably too many short stories to be working on at one time. So a lot of work's in progress right now.
Is there any thought to a longer work, a novel or anything like that?
The third, I'm thinking a lot about two different projects, and one of them is the third WXXT book, which will be, I think, kind of an all-out battle between agents of the FCC and the dark forces in the town of Leeds. I think that's going to be very much like a novel, with short pieces kind of interspersed throughout, but I think it's going to be the closest in narrative structure to a novel. And then another project that's kind of along the lines of Gateways, but a whole different scenario. And I don't want to talk too much about it yet because I don't want to give it up too soon, but it is a concept that has me really energized and excited. And even though that's who knows where down the line, I've already started putting together notes for it and working on it. So I've got a lot going right now. But yeah, I think the third WXXT book, whenever that comes along, will look a lot more like a novel than the previous ones had.
What's your writing schedule like?
It's about to change. Right now, it is mostly on the weekends. I've had a job with a long commute, which has cut into my writing time a lot. But I'm starting a job soon where I'm going to have an extra hour and a half in the morning. In the morning is when I tend to be the most productive. So it looks like I'll be writing daily in the mornings and a little bit on the weekends. Before that, it was pretty much mostly on the weekends, maybe a paragraph in a notebook here or there, or recording something on my phone on the way to work or something like that. So not as intensive as I like to get when I write.
An extra hour and a half a day, that's almost like 90 minutes extra.
almost.
And do you stick to that? Do you write daily?
Well, we'll see, because again, this is going to be a new schedule for me, but I've vowed to write daily, whether it's, you know, whether I keep what I write or not. just to keep those muscles, you know, going. So we'll see. I'll get back to you and let you know. But my intention is to write every morning and on the weekends as well to step it up.
Matt, are you familiar with number stations?
I am. Those are, yeah, I love listening to those. They're so eerie and strange.
I thought if anybody might be, you would be. And I was curious if you're going to be throwing any of those in or possibly into a future work.
There could be an element of that down the line, certainly. I listen to them on YouTube and on websites when I can find them. And
you don't have the Conet box?
Was it? No.
Oh.
I guess maybe you should explain, probably better coming from you, what a number station is.
Probably not the best thing coming from me. I know they're kind of like odd broadcasts where people repeat phrases or just say numbers, and no one knows the genesis of them. But I'm not really an expert on them. I don't really know that much. And it's something like people have talked about it so much, and it's I think there was a movie around number stations and a Banshee chapter. I don't know if any of you have seen
it. Oh, yeah, that's right. Pete and I saw that.
Banshee chapter was really good. There's a John Cusack film about number stations dealing with spies.
I don't know that one. Yeah.
I don't remember that one being all that good. It's been
It wasn't that good.
Yeah.
If I were to incorporate it, I'd want to come up with something sort of unique and different. And I don't know. It's certainly one of the many avenues of radio and broadcast that I want to explore as when I move forward with my radio-related stories.
Well, one of the many theories for the audience is that these are basically for spies or for, you know, agents in other countries.
Mm.
So, you know, sending out coded messages, and you don't have to be in a particular, particular place. You don't have to have a particular piece of equipment, I should say, other than an AM radio.
Okay.
To get right. The code, yeah. So.
And for anyone who's interested, you can go on to YouTube and just look for Conet. There's also a wonderful box set that collects hours and hours of these. And like Matt said, some are repeated phrases, some are just numbers, some are just letters, some are sentences, some are in English, some are in Swedish, some are in German. There are some that are snippets of music.
I can't figure out the one that kept saying I-9 and B-4. You know, what that one was for.
There are things that come on.
Yelled bingo.
There are things that come on specific days at the exact same time. And, you know, it's like, I don't know. Let's say the Tattered King. And that's it. And it's gone. It's there at 5 o'clock every Thursday at, you know, and you get those three words and then that's it for a week. Your mic's exactly right. Most people consider them something affiliated with spies and covert communications.
They're pretty fascinating. That's for sure.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. I remember years ago when the first version of the Conet box set came out, and I'm like, excuse me? And I just happened to be a couple weeks later in a store, and it's set in front of me, and it was didn't matter what it sounded like once I took it home. I just had to buy it. And I sat there for like 5 hours engrossed in these things. And on the box, some of them are a minute long. Some of them are several minutes long. I actually have 500 pages of my own version of a Conet written. It'll never see print because it's so strange. And it was just done literally as an odd amusement, a reaction to what this thing is. It's one of the things I so love about Matt's work. I love this radio station. just more. Matt's radio station is heroin. You get that taste, and it's more. Give me more. And the fact that we don't get tons, we get little bits and pieces. It's like, I don't know, it's like weather patterns or atmospheric conditions are such that it only tunes in every so often.
Yeah.
And you'll get this little mysterious, wonderful piece, and then it's gone again, and it's like, shit, come on, I was going to listen to that for like 5 hours. What are you doing to me?
Yeah, Pete.
But yeah, I don't know which is more frightening to me, is like the giant storm which you prepare for and then ride out for, you know, 3 or 4 hours, or the lone lightning bolt that comes down and strikes and is gone. You know, both are terrifying, but the short, sharp shocks are a different kind of satisfaction.
Yeah.
I'm a fan.
I was curious.
Go ahead.
I was just curious what some of the themes Matt's exploring in the new work that's coming up from Dunham's. Is it WXXT related?
Let's see. I can
the
kind
cosmic
of tell.
Horror. Or?
It's kind of surreal horror, maybe. There's a story about a meat manager in a supermarket who happens upon a bizarre psychic who reads things in slabs of meat in the supermarket. There's a very surreal story about a magician and his apprentice. And I know that's the kind of thing that's been done many a time. So I tried to do something a little bit different and, again, sort of surreal with it. There is a story, a corporate horror sort of story, where middle management is replaced by mannequins that run from wires in the ceiling.
How could you tell the difference?
Well, yeah, I wouldn't lie and say there isn't some commentary in that, but I don't know. And there's a couple of very short pieces like the flash fiction that I do, but. Yeah, I think it's a good chance to show something a little bit different. So hopefully I achieved that. There's also a radio-themed piece that has nothing really to do with WXXT. And that one, I think, I'm interested in the reaction to that. But it's another sort of surreal story about a radio DJ who does a stunt where he stays up for a long a period of time on air. And what happens to him, to his psyche afterward, after that project is over. And that's based on a true story.
Matt, is there anything that we didn't get a chance to ask you or didn't think to ask you, or anything that you want to talk about that we didn't cover?
Let me see. I don't think so. No, I think we pretty much covered it. I guess I can tell you a little bit about the witch cult in Western Massachusetts, which is, I think, a book we didn't go into
right.
very much. But this is a very slender chapbook illustrated by an artist named Alex Feynman. It is basically 13 fictional biographies of witches and warlocks in Western Massachusetts, some of which are directly related to WXXT, some of which are kind of out of left field. And that's another sort of short self-published piece that I'm very proud of. And it kind of gets shunted aside a little bit, but it's kind of an oddball project that it's in similar vein to the rare book catalog.
And it's one lovely. It's a lovely, strange book. Yeah.
Thank you. I wrote it to be reread. Go ahead.
Is that one in print, Matt?
It is. That one's on Amazon, along with Gateways and Creeping Waves. Yep.
I will pick it up.
What are you reading these days, Matt? What do you find especially interesting that you would recommend?
Well, I'm just finishing up to the chagrin of some people who don't have it yet, Laird Barron's new book. I know, I'm sorry. It had to be said.
It had to be said.
Yeah, but it's a powerful, powerful book and brutal. And I mean, in a way, it's what you'd expect, but in a way, it ratchets everything up to like the highest decibel you can imagine. It's a very, very, very good book, and I think it'll do very well, and with good reason. I read a new chapbook by Christopher Ropes called Complicity. I think he's a new writer to really watch out for. That book is from Dunham's Manor Press as well. And I met Chris Ropes in New Jersey at CrawlCon a little while back. And he's just a fiercely intelligent guy and a tremendous writer. I think you'll be hearing a lot more from him.
I optioned that story.
Oh, did you?
For a screenplay, yeah.
Oh, yeah. I think he mentioned that. But
I got an early look at it. Yeah, it's a great story.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And then I've been able to pick up some Ramsey Campbell short fiction that I hadn't read before, so I'm excited about delving into that. So I'm pretty much steeped in genre stuff right now with plans to. I like to try to read widely, as is always recommended, but there's such a tremendous wealth of good weird fiction and horror fiction being written right now that I'm really much, very much immersed in that. And SP, I'll be reading your new book as soon as it arrives in my house. Is it pronounced Muscadines?
Muscadines.
Muscadines. Yes. I'm very much looking forward to that. And then once I've read these 10 or 12 books, I'll probably be stepping out of the genre a little bit and doing some different reading.
Mm-hmm. And you and I have a story. Well, we have a stories in a new book that just came out last week, Ravenwood Quarterly.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yes. Yeah. I have a story in Ravenwood Quarterly, which is an out-and-out Lovecraft satire called The Terrible Old Friend. And it's, again, something very, very different, not like anything I think that I've done before. It's kind of humorous, but it also has a strong element of cosmic horror in it. And that's another one I'm interested to see the reaction, because it's so out of what I normally do. And I think somewhere down the line, talking about future projects, I have an idea for a small self-published book of just Lovecraft satires. Loving Lovecraft satires.
Joe, you had another question, right?
Yeah, we sort of already hit about it on it in the last minute or so, but
okay.
Even though you're spending so much time currently reading various weird fiction things, and you said you'd read King and Ligotti and whatnot previously, and what outside the box have you read and do you adore in the past? I mean, I think it's quintessential for us as we're expanding our horizons to read as much out of the box as is possible. What did you, other than horror, like before?
Let's see. I read Javier Marias, a Spanish writer, who my brother recommended to me, who I like very much. I'm a big fan of Richard Yates. Y-A-T-E-S. He did Revolutionary Road.
Revolutionary Road, yeah.
Right. But his other books beyond that are just excellent.
6 o'clock we glimpse.
His short stories are great, too, Yates.
Yes, yeah. 11 Kinds of Loneliness is one book that's excellent. And then The Easter Parade and Other Stories, yeah. I think, is another collection of short stories of his. So, yeah, I get a huge kick out of him. I've read a lot of Hunter Thompson. I love J.D. Salinger, a little bit of John Irving, although not too much that he's done recently. I also like poetry, like T.S. Eliot's The Wasteland is something I get obsessed with from time to time. And I find myself in some ways emulating that. E.E. Cummings, I love.
Cummings is God.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely, yeah. William S. Burroughs, I picked up a little bit more by him. I haven't read him in a while, so I'm kind of going back there a little bit. And of course, after this is over, I'll think about 20 more that I wish I had mentioned, but they're not.
Salinger doesn't need the plug.
No, that's true. Yeah, he's fine. Although, aren't there supposed to be new books from him, like starting last year? And I don't think anything's ever going to come of that.
Nine Stories is one of my favorite books ever. That's for sure.
Yeah, Nine Stories is amazing. Nine Stories are amazing.
All right. Well, Matt, really appreciate you coming on and talking to us.
I appreciate being on very much.
And again, your first book is Gateways to Abomination.
Yep.
And then we have, Rangel's sold out, correct? There's
correct.
No way to get that.
But that story is in Creeping Waves.
So plus that's the
right.
Best Weird
Creeping Waves.
Right. Yeah. Year's Best Weird.
And it'll be in Year's Best Weird Fiction, which is wonderful to be in a book alongside Robert Aichman and Ramsey Campbell and others is, yeah.
And Mike, these are all linked to on the e-zine webpage.
Great.
Okay. Thanks.
I've also heard that you've got a story coming up in Strange Eons magazine.
That's true. A collaboration with my friend Tom Breen. This story we wrote at a convention that was not very, I guess it was kind of sparsely attended, good. Or at least our table.
You gave him the bottom of the barrel. Is that what you're saying?
Right. That's funny. Now, Tom and I passed a laptop back and forth, and what we came out with is something that I reread, and I'm very proud of it. And I'm excited beyond words. It's going to be in Strange Eons. It's a neat story. Very, very, very odd. It's got a lot of Tom's particular flavor and kind of intermingled with my sort of stuff. So, yeah, I'm excited about that one.
So are we.
Good.
When will that be out then, Kelly?
Oh, shut up.
I'm serious. I wasn't being funny.
That'll be issue 21. Issue 20 is at the printers right now, so I'm guessing it'll be in the next 2 or 3 months.
Okay. All right. All right, issue 21. Well, thanks, Matt.
Thank you.
Appreciate you coming on, and it was great to see you again. And all you got to do is close the window, and it'll kick you out of here. So.
Okay, great to see you, too, and I hope you feel better.
Thanks, Matt.
All right.
Have a good night.
Bye, folks.
See you, Matt.
Bye, Matt.
Bye.
What's...
Cool guy.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
What is Strange Eons again? Is that a magazine?
It's just a little rag that you get. It's right next to Hustler, I think, on the publisher stand.
Okay. Matt, you wanted to plug the Dark Reasons Indiegogo? Is that what you said?
Oh, it was last week. What happened, Mike, was after you couldn't have a show, believe it or not, the cool kids stayed after class. And we chatted for 2 hours. And I put together a post. I put it on the e-zine from about a week ago, which was a review of recent noir mythos comics. And there is a there are a couple that are mainly available through Kickstarter. There's a new one out from this isn't from Kickstarter. This is from Dark Horse called Weird Detective, which is a great Lovecraftian noir comic. They're at 3 issues now. I assume there'll be DVD. Graphic novel compilations. It is well worth it. We all know about the great series Fatal from Brubaker, which is a great noir comic. It's not even mythos, really. It's Lovecraftian. But the one that I'm talking about lately is Case File Arkham. And this is a hard-boiled detective redoing Lovecraft stories. So it's kind of like from the perspective of a gumshoe. The first one was they were redoing Pickman's model, and he's searching for Pickman, who's gone missing. So I think it was just a very entertaining and well-done comic book, if you like that kind of thing. But if you go back on your webpage about the public e-zine webpage about a week. I got a kind of survey.
Okay.
Well worth it for people who are fans of comics. I'll put a link on the webpage.
That's Cat Roach's company too. That's 01 Publishing.
The Case File.
Besides, besides doing that, she did the Whispers from the Abyss and Whispers from the Abyss 2 Kickstarter that was funded just recently. So she's kicking ass.
Yeah, and I've linked to that several times. I'll keep doing that until they're done. So yeah. All right. So first of all, I should have said at the beginning of the show, but between now and next Sunday, the giveaway for this week is Laird Barron gave me some audible.com codes for X's for Eyes. And so I'm going to give away four of those for this week's listeners. So in other words, today is September the 18th, 2016. If you're listening to this or watching this in between now and next Sunday morning, which would be the 25th, then you can get in on this. And I'll tell you how at the end of the show if you don't know already. But X's Fries is a really good book. So I haven't heard the Audible version of it yet, but I'm sure it's great. Here's something sort of that I think is worth discussing. I don't want to discuss it in any kind of light as far as, okay, this publisher's doing it wrong, this publisher's doing it right, anything like that, because I don't think, I think rarely is the truth that clear cut. I think usually the truth falls somewhere in the middle, and people oftentimes don't acknowledge that. It also makes you kind of unpopular with both sides in many arguments. But one publisher wrote, now this is a public post, he wrote on Facebook, someone explain to me why I keep using the proceeds from book sales to publish new books when the industry, I can't talk because of this strep, standard seems to involve constant utilization of crowdfunding. And I've seen some small press publishers crowdfund a lot. I've seen some do it not at all. And then, you know, several right in the middle. You know, for example, we were just talking about Kat Rocha. So is that how you say her last name, Rocha?
I think it's Rocha.
Rocha, okay. So I don't – I crowdfunded an anthology mainly because I'm not rich. And then I published other books without crowdfunding. So, you know, again, I really honestly want to throw this out there and discuss it not as one's right and one's wrong, because I really don't believe that. I do think you can go too far on the crowdfunding end. So any thoughts leap to mind right away, anybody?
Well, I was going to...
just want to accept what I say and leave it at that?
Well, I can give you my perspective.
Okay, Philip.
Well, I had a very direct situation where there was debate about a book that I that they had requested a story from me for, and they were actually polling to a degree the authors, and the debate was, we can either pay you this much for the story and keep it in house and do it the way we always do it, or we can pay you pro rates and potentially get a little bit more promotion if we crowdfund it, because we don't have the funds to do that version of this, you know, book model, business model, distribution model.
Okay.
So that was the only time it's really come up to me, you know, where I've been directly involved with it. So I think that sometimes that is the thinking do that kind of level of product, and, you know, more, it's more about the distribution and the back end and about what the authors are getting paid, and maybe less about the book itself.
How many small publishers, like so many of them go under. We've seen so many small presses that we all like just tank. None of them have the capital to put out a print run of even a soft cover book. It can run in a couple of $1,000s. And we're asking the publishers that they're going to be fronting their personal money with no guarantee they'll make it back. This allows us, well, the reason I like crowdfunding is it allows books to be produced I'll never otherwise get by authors that I like, in a genre that I like, and I'm happy to support it in that regard. I know, okay, if I pay $25 to support a Kickstarter, and I might get a $15 book in return, I didn't pay the money to get the book. You know what I mean? I paid the money because I want to see the book in print. And well, so yeah. I'm all in favor of it.
Yeah.
Well, there's also, there's a sort of this idea that, you know, either way works, because in one section you're fronting the money and you hope to make it up in the back end. And in the Kickstarter or the Indiegogo, you're asking, well, how many people are really interested in this book? It's sort of a litmus test of saying, well, am I going to have enough sales to make a profit in a reasonable amount of time? Right. Which, you know, can be very difficult for some of these small press books, particularly from presses that aren't super well established. It's kind of nice to say, hey, I've already got 100 copies sold before you even go to print.
Mm-hmm.
I know.
There have been Kickstarters that have come out that have, with very, very popular authors attached, that have failed.
Yeah.
Because the interest isn't there. It's market is saturated or whatever.
Actually,
or the Kickstarter wasn't promoted correctly.
Right. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. They reached too far. Like they say they want to raise $30,000 instead of saying they want to raise $7,500 or $10,000.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't like get a big buy in the beginning, it's very hard to generate the excitement. To like generate that much money, it's very easy, or much easier, say, to generate a Kickstarter for, say, $10,000 over a month when you've got a genre like this. I think that a lot of the ones that fail, they ask for too much money.
And yeah. Frankly, right now, I'm involved in a Kickstarter for three books coming out from Dark Regions Press. They've bundled them all together into one Kickstarter. With a very high goal, $30,000 for three books. So,
what's the reasoning behind that rather than doing it book by book? Because if it fails, then all three books fail.
Well, I think the way it's actually designed is that it's for add-ons. The books are going to be made regardless, but the Kickstarter is for additional art, that kind of stuff.
Well, and that's an excellent point, Pete, because there's a difference between a fundraiser where the book is going to be made regardless and one where it's, if this fails, it's not going to get made. Like, I fully admit, obviously, with Autumn Cthulhu, if I hadn't reached my fundraising goals, the book wasn't going to get made. Or I'd have to be real creative about getting financing elsewhere.
Right. You also weren't asking for a lot of money over what it costs to make the book.
Right.
No, and that's a real Kickstarter. I don't know if secret's the word, besides great rewards and a great product.
And stretch goals.
And stretch goals.
Is not to ask too much, I guess.
Yeah, well, you know, it's a good point, Kelly, because without naming Kickstarter projects, because I you know, I see a lot of them, obviously we're all in the same circles, and sometimes I'm like, it's like, yeah, well, the reward is you know $30 and you get one of the paperbacks, or that's the you know, the thing you can do, and it's like, well, how is that benefiting me as a selfish consumer if I'm sure. You know, I'm paying $30 in advance for a book that may or may not be made. When the book comes out, I can spend $30 or probably less and buy it. You know, it's almost like there's no real benefit to it.
Yeah, because not everyone thinks the same way Matt does. I think it's an admirable way to think, but not everybody thinks that way. The thing I was going to say a minute ago and forgot was that I asked for $10,000, and I think, if I remember right, we ended up somewhere around 19, and we made 10 in like 3 or 4 days. Mm-hmm. It's a lot. I think a secret is if you reach your funding fairly quickly like that, it generates a lot of excitement. From people who haven't given yet. So
I think, well, these campaigns succeed or fail, in my experience, on the basis of how many people you get to promote and repost and pass them around. I mean, there was just one a few days ago that was for Orin Gray, for a book by Orin Gray. And I always think that you have to kind of get people stirred up about it. You have to present it in a certain way. You have to say something about it that's enticing. But then it just depends on how many people you get to repost. And you get a certain number of people doing that, and you're coming into the final stretch, if they're doing that a couple of times a day on Twitter and on Facebook, you know, people do get excited. They get the idea that, oh, as you said, as you pointed out earlier, oh, I'm going to be responsible for helping to publish this book. This is going to be something that I push over the top. So,
and you don't want to miss the boat, you know, when you see it's getting funded. Like the Orin Gray one's a great example. It's a book that was already published that they're putting out in a deluxe edition. And my personal response was, well, I don't want to miss the boat on getting that. So I'm definitely going to pay the money in advance. Because I know I'm kind of getting my book dealer.
So, you know.
But you got to get that momentum. You know, the campaign has to have that momentum, and it depends on the goodwill of all the people who know you and know about the book to continue, you know, posting about it and to keep it going and to get other people excited about it. I think people get very excited near the end if they see that you're going to make it. Or they're not quite sure. Yeah, you know, people want to help. They want to be the person who pitched in another $30. And, you know, especially if you've only got like $400 to go. I think most of the people who see a campaign like that and it's in its last few days will try to help out. So,
sure. I really, really liked what Matt had to say a few minutes ago about fundraisers being for books. That this is a product that would not have made it otherwise, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So.
Okay, let's look at, I've edited a book for Olfar Press, and I thought it was a very nice book. The there's another book that we want to start submitting, editing stories for, or rather reading stories for, but it's not live yet. Part of the thing is the publisher, he puts up all the money himself. So he's got to come up with a certain amount of cash because and it's like you say, the pay is not great for these authors. It's like a penny a word plus like a couple copies of the book. I got paid 5 copies of the book. He had to pay for the art and the formatting. And then I think for the most part it was, you know, this was like, he had to come up with like, it was like over $1,000, $2,000, something like that, which sounds very modest. But what if you don't have that kind of money sitting around and you're trying to pay the rent? So this book will probably be open for submissions eventually, but only when the publisher can afford it. And so instead of like, you know, starting sooner and having like a more professional editing job, it's basically we're limited by money, and that's to me where the crowdfunding could come in and improve the product. But then I guess we don't have the interest, it's kind of hard to get it going.
Yeah, it's definitely a catch-22. Somebody in that comment thread said something about that I thought was a bit unfair, and they said, well, because you don't have the time to you know, create coins and bookmarks and all that crap. Well, yeah, if it's some silly bookmark that nobody wants, then nobody's going to want it. But if it's an actual reward that people are going to want, then that's just one more incentive to make the book, the real prize, happen. So,
yeah, that's a bit of the crime with this whole thing, because I'm in the same thought process as Philip, where he says as a selfish consumer, you know, he's not willing to put $30 into a paperback copy of a book. But on the other hand, Mike, I know that you funded it almost 200%, but I don't think that you got paid anything. And nobody understands the fact that the person who's running this should be paid something for their work. You know, whenever we jump into these things, we're all doing it as kind of a labor of love. And when you Kickstarter, I think that's expected by the consumer.
Well, can I just comment? Mike can comment too. That extra money was not pocketed by the Easy. He used it to get more authors to participate.
Mm-hmm. No, that's exactly what I was saying, is that the work that was put into this project was not paid for. Only the project was paid for.
Yeah, and to clarify my statement, I was saying I do want to spend $30 on a paperback book that's going to come out regardless of whether I fund it or not. And that's case by case. Sometimes I'm excited and I want to be part of it. But like Mike did with Autumn Cthulhu, he had alternate book covers for certain levels of...
coins. And the coins are beautiful.
I didn't get a coin.
Yeah, well, Philip, you know, I don't think there's anything wrong per se with one way of thinking or the other. It's incumbent upon the person who's doing the fundraiser to make people want to give to it, to create a product, mm-hmm. and to create compelling enough reasons besides, and hopefully this is one of those reasons, but reasons besides I'm a nice guy, or don't you want to see one more weird fiction book published? Well, yeah, of course we do, but that's not a compelling enough, that's not a compelling enough reason. Thoreau wrote something in Walden, I'm going to get this, but some of the effect of he studied on how not to create baskets instead of studying how to make people want to buy them. If you're going to sell something, you've got to give somebody a really compelling reason to buy it.
The other factor here is that your previous work. If I've funded a Kickstarter with you and I got your first product and it was okay, and you come to me with a second one, I might not go for it.
Yeah.
The first one was just okay. Frankly, some of the things that I've bought from these crowdfundings have been less than okay. They've been subpar. And so I choose not to fund the second one or the third one or the fourth one. And if I really want the book, I'll pick it up after it's released to the public. Usually at a cheaper price.
If you're going to do that kind of funding, if you're going to do it, you have to not be ambivalent about it. You have to not think, we'll try this, but you know, if people don't get really excited about it right away, then oh well. Or I'm not sure I want to do this. I'm not sure I approve of this kind of fundraising, but I'm going to try it. You just can't have that attitude about it at all. You have to go at it completely. And you have to have great enthusiasm for the project. Mike, the thing that got all of those people interested is the fact that you were so excited about the anthology. You wanted to publish this anthology. You loved these stories. And you have a track record. People can see what you've already accomplished.
That's a big part of it, yeah.
So, yeah, given your track record and the fact that you love the book and you love these stories and you were all for it, you were for it 100%, that makes a huge difference. You shouldn't do this if you're ambivalent about it. Keep thinking about it. Look at other ways that you can publish your book. But if you're going to commit to a campaign where you're going to have to go online and ask people to send you some money, you better believe in doing it that way. Don't do it that way if you don't want to. That's fine too. But if you do it, if you do fundraising in this way, you have to believe in it 100%.
What I do think is wrong, though, is anyone on either side, any publisher on either side, kind of sniffing or turning their nose up at the way that the other side does it. As long as you're delivering a great product and you've got great customer service. If there's an issue, you know, you take care of the issue, mm-hmm. then you know?
You do it your way. Yeah, you should do it your way. Yeah.
I mean, I know publishers who never have to have to do a fundraiser. In other words, they're not poor like me, but they could do better in other departments. For example, their marketing, you know, so it's really, nobody's perfect.
Yeah. Earlier tonight, SP was talking about, you know, all the different ways that we treat art differently. You know, if you're independent, you know, filmmaker, you get applauds. If you're an independent musician, you get applauds. But if you're an independent writer, you're like, eh.
The stigma.
But on the flip side, if you're a corporate artist, people look down on you.
That's a good point.
I guarantee you that's because picking up a guitar is hard for most people to do. But everybody sits in front of a keyboard, and that means that everybody can write. And
everybody can write. Yeah.
That's the mentality.
Yeah.
But to me, it doesn't really matter how you get the funding. It's about the work. If yes, you got it out there. Now let's judge it on its own merits.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Mm-hmm. And I do think that the perception is, from what I've read, and even to some degree agree with, is there can be overboard, you know. I think it's good to have it, you know. I think when you're publishing a book a month and it's your model and it's your consistent model and you're going out with a new Kickstarter every couple months for a new, it does make you want, I don't know, it gives one pause because it makes you wonder what the business model, if you can't, you know, I don't know, it doesn't,
yeah, you can definitely oversaturate the market, Philip. Yeah, you're definitely right.
Because you have to go back to the same people again and again to get them to repost and tell their friends about it. And if you exhaust that goodwill, then people are just not going to listen to you anymore.
Well, and not just exhaust the goodwill. Maybe you don't ever do it. Maybe you don't. But there's still diminishing returns there, wouldn't you think? So at some point.
And I'm just thinking back, I kind of recall that, you know, there was a time in this world where musicians were looked down on and writers were rock stars. Mm. And now it's kind of reversed.
When Salinger walked the earth, writers were gods.
Yeah. But it's become even more an instant gratification world than it ever was, and what we do is not instant gratification. It requires you, whether you read on a device or whether you read an old-fashioned paper product, to sit somewhere and spend an amount of time absorbing this work to get the reward. This is a world of 140 characters. Or here's a cool GIF on Facebook, or it's a 4-minute song. So anything under that entertainment umbrella, or whatever we want to call it, it's fast. You know, it's snip, snip, snip. It's going 1,000 miles an hour at light speed with your hair on fire. That's how everything comes at you. And, you know, to read the new Laird Barron novel, you know, or short story collection, that is incredibly rewarding experience. But it's going to require you to sit somewhere and take a chunk of time to get through it. It's not 4 minutes, you know.
Right.
And seems that there's more and more people in the world, whether they're busier or whatever, that do not want to invest as much time. The other thing is, Pete's absolutely right. There was a time when writers were rock stars. Mm-hmm. A lot of that time, or we could argue to some degree, that there were less options. stop and think about when we were children, or, well, some of us, because one of us is older than most everybody here. There was a television in my house when I was a kid. It wasn't for the children. We got to watch it here and there when it wasn't being used by the adults. We were outside. We were engaged in our pursuits, and there was a telephone in my house. And I don't ever remember a single time until I was an advanced teenager where it rang and was for me, or that I used it. You know, electronic devices, which there are numerous, and how many little kids now, by the time they're in kindergarten or first grade, have computer experience, or some kind of video game experience. There are a lot more things yelling and screaming for people's time. So large investments, a novel, a short story collection, it's not where tastes run nowadays, or an awful lot of them, unfortunately.
Yeah, that's why the novella is getting more popular.
But I think even television, I think even with television, we were sort of on the road to that loss of the mystique of writing. I remember when I was a kid watching a lot of successful writers who were legendary appeared on television, and this sort of started out talking about writing and talking about books, and a lot of those situations kind of devolved into writer conflicts, feuds, famous feuds between writers who would appear on talk shows and get into it with one another. I think that we were sort of already on the road to demystifying what writers do and what writers are about. And I think, you know, to go back again, Phil, to one of our favorite writers, Salinger, I think that one of the enduring things about his work and his mystique is that he wasn't interested in any of that. He wanted to get as far away from that as he possibly could. He didn't want to be himself in front of people. He didn't want to come out and present himself. He didn't want that aspect to be part of his writing. I can remember when I was a little kid watching Harlan Ellison hold forth with Tom Snyder. I just, you know, smoking cigarette after cigarette, and the two of them would just talk dirt about Hollywood. And I kept thinking, this is what a writer does, I guess. You know, this is what a writer is like. But I think television was already one step in that direction that you're talking about, Joe, where it's all sort of, you know, taken for granted, and people think, you know, less of writers and what they do. They shouldn't, but I mean, and they should never have thought that writing was some mystical, magical thing to begin with. But I kind of think that we were already well on the road to people losing respect for the whole process of writing and what writing is about by the time a lot of writers were appearing on television.
Yeah, I think my opinion. Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
No.
I was going to say, it's interesting to see, to Joe's point and to that point, you know, I think about Norman Mailer, and I kind of, for some reason, I have Norman Mailer in my head as the writer who bridged the old media and the new media of that time. You know, he was on TV a lot. He had that presence, that personality. Hemingway was not so much. And it's, you know, nowadays, and I mentioned this to Matt, it's interesting to see what people are beginning to think a little bit outside the box. There's a James Frey YA series that he does that you read the book and then you go on the internet and there's all these clues and it's like a treasure hunt of sorts, and it's very popular, and there's a few books that have been like that more for teens, than anything, but I can sort of see a world not too far away where there's a little more of a bridge between what happens to Joe's point in these short bursts on online where the kids are, the YouTube, you know, and Snapchat and all this other stuff. My kid does it. I don't know anything about. And then, and you know, and books, there's, you know, where literature is going, how it's getting out there. There may be an opportunity for there to be a new form of literary rock star whose presence is partially in that world of new media and partially in the world of old media. I can definitely see it happening. It would be interesting to see how it would be pulled off, but I could mm-hmm. definitely see it happening.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, I mean, anything's possible. The other thing too is, literature, I don't think was seen as entertainment decades ago. Nowadays, everything's owned by big corporations. There's all kinds of everything from Hippocampus Press to Lovecraft Easing Press to Dim Shores that aren't big corporations. But in general, books are no different. If you're Warner's or whoever currently owns Warner, I don't know. Kelly will know. But I'm Warner's, and I got television assets, and I got film assets, and I got book assets, and I probably have sports assets, and I have all this different stuff. And at the end of the day, they're all forms of entertainment. Doesn't matter what they actually are. To me, in that boardroom, they're forms of entertainment. And this one is worth a lot of money. And this one, it just trickles in. But this one gives me a little prestige. And this one's slop, but it reels in the cash. So the one we're working in, we would still like literature to be literature. But the world, or at least I think a major piece of the world, and even the consumer by conditioning at this point sees what we do as just another form of entertainment. So which one has got the most bling? Which one's the coolest? Yep. Great. I love Stephen King. I've loved Stephen King since The Stand. The Stand was like, wow, who is this cat? I adore this guy. Nice to see Stephen King. It's nice to see Stephen King is still a rock star. I would like to see more rock stars. I think we're watching the birth of one of the most brilliant in Laird Barrett. Every day I hope that one day he wakes up and he is Stephen King. And I believe he will be. But we're producing old school product in a new school world. That every day the new school distances itself further and further from where we are. So, you know,
excuse me.
But that's just, you know, something, well, I think.
But that's
I don't have statistics and facts to back it up.
I mean, that's the old argument. That's literature versus genre fiction. I mean, in a lot of ways, literature.
No. Whoa. Absolutely not. Literature is literature. I'm talking, Dr. Seuss is literature. Laird Barron is literature. E.E. Cummings is literature. I'm talking about books in general. There are shit books and there are incredible books. There are books that get an A+ and a C- and a D, and there are failure after failure after failure. I don't put weird fiction or crime or pulp or children's books or young adults into some little redheaded stepchild box. That's absolutely wrong-headed. Yeah, we need to call Autumn Cthulhu weird fiction because we need to sell it. And I don't mean Mike Davis calls it weird fiction to sell it. I mean a critic does, a reviewer does, a bookstore does. That does not diminish the work. I don't see
yeah.
Thomas, we can turn around in our libraries. The Imago sequence. 4 or 5 Ramsey Campbell. The Parasite by Ramsey Campbell. Ligotti. Cisco. Those are not lesser works because someone might term them weird fiction or horror fiction. They are in no way, shape, or form lesser works. Those were just tags affixed. So I'm sorry, I didn't mean to slap you. It just, for me, I find that offensive that, oh, that's just weird fiction. A great work of literature. It doesn't matter what it is.
No, and I wasn't saying one is more. I mean, I read genre fiction. I was saying it's the same kind of argument that it's the same argument that people who have had that other argument have. It's like they need to classify everything, and media is just another way to classify stuff. I mean, entertainment. You know, to your point, entertainment. You know, books are seen as entertainment, or you know, a book seen as, you know, something more substantial. That's, I guess, the question I was asking, my reference I was making.
Well, I do think in the past books were seen as something more substantial, some more so than others. But I think they're seen as a lot less substantial now.
Rick, you had a comment, and then I got to get back to bed, I think.
Okay. Just that books and magazines were gods up until the 1940s. Mm. I mean, that when Lovecraft was writing, if you were a successful magazine author, you were a god.
You know, if this was...
And they were paid well.
Television was the thing.
Yeah, F. Scott Fitzgerald published his work that way. A lot of his work came out in magazines first.
Yeah. And magazines paid a lot of money.
Yeah.
Yeah, and it was television, which was the ultimate thing, which did in the magazine industry, as for fiction magazine industry.
All right. Well, I'm sorry. I guess I'm not really cutting it short. But go take care of this strip. If you want a audible copy of X's for Eyes, just I'm giving away 4. Or I should say Laird's giving away 4. I'm just precipitating it. Send an email to lovecrafteasingprizes@gmail.com. Please put X's for Eyes in the subject of the email anytime between now and September the 25th. And send it to, again, lovecrafteasingprizes@gmail.com. You can put anything you want in the body of the email. And I'll pick 4 winners next Sunday with random.org. So thanks, everybody. Appreciate it. And we'll see you all next week.